the chairperson would say, why are we here today? And then they would all chant, to make revolution. And the chairperson would say, what kind of revolution? And then they would say, sexual revolution. And how are we going to do that? By destroying the family. And they would say this, how are we going to do that? By destroying the family, by destroying marriage. How do we do that? By destroying monogamy. And how do we do that? And then they would say, by promoting homosexuality, prostitution, promiscuity, and abortion.
If you're going to smash monogamy, you're going to end up with a lot of neglected kids. And one of the ways of rationalizing is that, well, kids don't really need their parents, because really what kids need is privacy to have sex with each other.
The complete destruction of traditional marriage and the nuclear family is the revolutionary or utopian goal of feminism. She declared her sympathy for intergenerational sex, saying that, quote, now this is a direct quote from Kate, age of consent laws are very oppressive to gay male youth. One of children's essential rights is to express themselves sexually with each other, but with adults as well. The sexual freedom of children is an important part of a sexual revolution.
Hey everyone, before we get started with this episode of the Dr. J Show, please subscribe to our channel, hit that notification button so you'll always know when a new episode drops, and start thinking now about who you know who needs this information. Now, on with the show. You may never have heard of Kate Millett, but she has definitely affected your life. Her book, Sexual Politics, was one of the key texts that launched the feminist movement in America, a movement whose self-contradictions continue to plague our country. Kate Millett's version of feminism influenced the founding of women's studies departments across the United States. She was on the cover of Time magazine in 1970. Kate Millett was also mentally ill. Not metaphorically, but literally mentally ill. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, an international interfaith coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Today, I'm excited to have Kate Millett's younger sister, Mallory, as my guest. Mallory Millett will tell us about Kate's lifelong mental problems and the political radicalism those problems fed. Mallory will also correct the record. Kate lied shamelessly about her family and her upbringing, and Kate's fans were classic enablers of her mental illness and violence. I know you're going to be fascinated by this interview, and you're going to want to return to it again and again. Mallory Millett, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you so much. I'm very happy to be here with you.
Well, great. I'm looking forward to our conversation. I heard you a couple of years ago, I think it's been by now, talking with Al Cresta on his program. And I was very fascinated. And I want to just explore this with you a little further. We're doing a special on women's history, real women's history, for Women's History Month. And I thought getting your take on your sister and her legacy would be a very helpful thing for our people. So your sister, Kate Millett, she was a feminist icon, I think it's safe to say, but you have revealed that she was mentally ill, not figuratively, not metaphorically, but literally mentally ill. Mallory, tell us about your sister, Kate.
Well, she was seriously mentally ill. It wasn't just that she was a little off, or she was quite mentally ill. And it was from a very early age. She was never quite right. When I was born, she was 5 years old. And she always says that feminism .2 started the day that I was born. I was born 5 years after her. And she was incredibly upset because she overheard my father sobbing on the telephone that his third child was yet another girl. And she heard him sobbing on the phone about the fact that I was a girl, and she became so incensed and so outraged that she never gave up on that. That really seeded her entire, the rest of her life, actually. But she was a problem every minute. She was expelled from every single school she ever entered multiple times. She was a hellion around the house. She had our house upset most of the time. She was always going, she was going from one tantrum to another. She was very, very threatening with me. From my earliest memories, I was being beaten up by my sister. She beat me up so much. She tried to kill me so many times. I moved around that house for the first, I'd say, 9 years of my life, just terrified I was going to be murdered. And so I have a way of walking through a house that's very gentle, very quiet. You don't even hear me coming. My husband always says, "You're such a quiet mover in the house. Why is that?" I said, "Because I couldn't be discovered by the terrible Kate." So it was a real, real, real bad situation. And
how did your parents deal with her violence? Weren't they concerned about her beating you up and trying to kill you?
Well, first of all, they didn't know a lot of what would go on because it would be when they were gone. And I would try to tell them, but my mother was so worried over how strange Kate was that she compensated for her all the time. She really just put most of her energy into the most problematic child. So I felt sort of neglected because I was just sort of normal. I was just doing the regular things. I wasn't having a fit about something every 15 minutes. So it garnered a lot of attention from everybody. But also, my husband's theory is that that's why my father left when I was 7 and Kate was 12. My husband always says, oh, he couldn't take 5 more minutes of Kate. You know, it just was an impossible situation. She was a very frightening person. You were really afraid that she might harm you physically. She could be very violent. So
do you think, if I could just add to you, do you think your father really didn't want you as a girl? Did you experience that from him, that he wanted a son and was disappointed that he had only girls? Is that real, or was that Kate's fantasy, or what?
I didn't experience that in the least. The full 7 years that I had a father, I really had a father. He would bathe me and put me to bed at night. He would read me. He read me Alice in Wonderland, Peter Pan. He read me all the great books sitting on his lap at night. He would sit by my bed and read to me. He gave me all my allergy shots while I would be sound asleep. He learned how to do it from the doctor. I experienced him as a very loving, hands-on, very masculine father. I remember some of the great joys of my life were just being carried from the car into the house while I was asleep by my daddy, you know, or he would carry me upstairs asleep. I loved him a lot. He was an alcoholic, and he was making my mother's life miserable in many ways. And so in some strange way, the night he left, I was happy because it was just that he was... there were too many bad scenes at night when he would come home drunk. One of my most vivid memories is being 7 years old and lying on my back in my bed at the top of the stairs and listening to him leave the house for the last time. There was a big fight between my mother and him, and it was about 2 o'clock in the morning, I think, and I heard him walk by my room and down the 16 steps that my room was on the top of. And I remember those 16 steps down, and I never heard him again in my house. He was gone forever. And he really deserted us completely.
Wow. Okay.
And I never received a birthday card. I never received a greeting, nothing from him. From the moment he left, he was gone.
Wow. And do you think that had an impact on Kate?
Oh, definitely. Because Kate was madly in love. Our father was an extremely romantic character. He had beautiful curly black hair and gorgeous blue eyes, and he was so good looking and so a gentle, loving, decent person when he was sober. He was really lovely, but he had a very serious drinking problem.
And so that affects, obviously, that affects the whole family when something like that happens.
Kate was, Kate was just madly in love with him. I mean, she just adored him. He was, you know, it was a very kind of a, you know, incestuous thing she had for him. It was really big. And so when he left, she was just enraged. She was totally destroyed.
But when you say incestuous, do you mean that metaphorically? Do you mean that metaphorically?
Well, I don't know. I thought she had a, you know, later in the years later, I realized that her, you know, she had a very strong attraction to my father. She just adored him. So I don't know how far that went with her really or anything, but she had a lot of romantic illusions about him. She wrote about him a lot.
I see. And do you feel that what she said about him was accurate?
No.
And the reason I'm asking is I saw in the Time magazine edition that featured your sister, she had some things to say about your dad. And I wondered, you know, how accurate that really was. So any light that you can shed on that would be helpful. Your memories would be helpful too.
I felt that the things that she said about him were very unfair and totally exaggerated. She that Time magazine article just laid him flat. The only time your name is ever in Time magazine and it says that you beat your children, the man was mortified. And so when he was just before he died, I think the year before he died, he ended up contacting Kate here in New York City. And he and Kate and I, he came to town and the three of us went out to dinner at a restaurant on Fifth Avenue. And that was the only time I saw my father from the time he left until he died about a year after that in 69. 71. He died in 71. So I think that her attachment to him and then her fantasies about him and then the fact that he did spank us occasionally, he did not beat us. I think she's grossly exaggerated this hatred for my father. And when he came to see us then, of course, we all had this sort of reunion for the three of us that didn't go anywhere. I mean, I never continued with him, but I kind of admired him for coming all the way to New York to face her over her saying that in Time magazine. He was very upset.
I see.
Have a cousin who always says to me, you know, she was an adult at the time, and she always says to me, don't believe one word that they say about your father. He was the most wonderful man I ever knew in my entire life. He was the sweetest person and the most generous and giving man. So, Mallory, just remember that about your father. That's how she remembers him, and she lived with us for a time. So,
I see. So I was
only seven, so I don't really remember him very well, you know.
Right. And you have a child's memories. You don't have the benefit of adult evaluation of your memories because not at all. Yeah. So, tell us more about Kate and your memories of Kate. What you've told us so far is that she was a holy terror around the family, and your mom didn't really know what was going on a lot of the time, and your mom. However, she was preoccupied with trying to deal with what she did know about Kate, which was that she was volatile. Is that fair to say that Kate was volatile?
Extremely volatile. And she was being, you know, expelled from every school she went to. And that was a real problem for my mother. She would have to be going up to the school for conferences with teachers all the time. I mean, she was a hellion. But I have to say, because I really want people to know this, I loved my sister. I mean, the three of us sisters had a kind of a bond. Sally was 10 when I was born, Kate was 5, and then I was born. So we're all 5 years apart. But, you know, I really loved my sister, and so I put up with a lot for a long, long time. When she did leave the family and go to live on the college campus at the University of Minnesota, I was very relieved because she was such a bully that I was simply terrified of her all the time. I was absolutely terrified of her because she used to beat my head on the sidewalk, pounding my head on the. She did so many terrible things to me physically and tried so hard to kill me that, you know, By the time it turned out that she was, in fact, officially mentally ill, which then again turned my sympathy toward her again, I had, you know, I had nothing to do with her really for about 8 years at one point. She
And
had
did she ever?
gone.
Sorry, go ahead. Go ahead.
She had gone to live outside the family. She had lived at school for a while, and then she went to Oxford University in England. And I ended up going to live in the Philippines with my first very young. I was very young when I got married. My husband was 10 years older, and he was made president of 3M Asia. He was only 30 years old, and I was 20. And we had a baby, and so my attention was averted. I had a little family. I went off to live in Southeast Asia. So I didn't see Kate for about 8 years. And I kind of assumed when I came back to America, because I never came back to America during those whole 8 years, I always just assumed that she had grown up, you know, that she would have grown and changed. So when I came to New York after coming back to America to join her, because she was extolling the life in New York, she was becoming famous, she was meeting everybody here, and she would say, come to New York, because I was in Hollywood. I had come back from Asia, and I was an actress in Los Angeles. And I was not, it's a terrible thing to be a young actress in Los Angeles. And I was very homesick. I'd never come home since I left Asia. And so she was constantly on the phone saying, come to New York, come to New York. We're starting the National Organization for Women, and you'll meet all these great women, and I'll get you started here. I'll get your life started in New York. So I came to New York with that hope. And I lived with her loft, and with her in her loft, her husband. And she lived in a Bowery loft, and she was just getting her PhD, and she had just finished her thesis. And in fact, I named her thesis, because I was living with them at the time, and she couldn't think of a title for it. And one night at dinner, I just said, well, how about sexual politics? It's all about sex and politics. Why don't you call it sexual politics? So that's what she called it. And her dissertation was published immediately, which is very unusual. They don't usually publish your PhD thesis. And the minute it was published, it was an overnight sensation. It was huge, Dr. Morris. It was just, it was so big. It was like, you know, Hunter Biden or something. It was enormous. I always say to people, if you stopped somebody in Rwanda in 1972, they knew who Kate Millett was. Now
Wow.
people in Ohio don't know who Kate Millett, and now they're forgetting her, which I consider
Right.
a great blessing, because I mention her
Right.
name to people now, and they've never heard of her. So it was a big thing. I was living with her. She had instant fame. She was on the cover of Time magazine within days after she published. I mean, they just came to her immediately. They put her on the cover. They decided they were going to do this big story about women's lib. And so they did the one that you've seen and the stuff that you saw that they published. But do you know that the lesbians got very upset that she did not say that she had a lesbian history? And so after the Time magazine article, they all pounced on her and said, you never said that you're a lesbian, so you left us all out, and you're a traitor. And so they had a meeting at the Judson Church here in New York where they confronted her. And there were two Time magazine reporters secluded in that meeting, and she had no idea of that. And so Time came out some weeks after the August 30th article that came out, a number of weeks, I don't remember how long after, with a brand new article about, forget Kate Millett, we just discovered she's a lesbian, which means she cannot speak for women because she's not a real woman. And so Time magazine did an article like that and sort of discredited
Wow.
her. And said that, you know, they took back everything they said about her, sort of, you know.
Crazy, crazy. So let me back up, though, and pick up a couple of these threads. So your sister, I think you mentioned that she was married to a man, and
yes.
yet she had a lesbian history. And so by today's standards, I'm not sure, would she even count as a lesbian? I mean, or she's situational lesbian, or how, you know, how would you describe it?
Well, she was completely
What did
straight.
They want her? What did they
She
want
was,
her to, what did they want her to do, the lesbians?
well, to
What were
represent
they at?
them. She wanted to. They wanted her to admit that she was a lesbian and that they could be counted in this women's lib thing. That the whole country would be in sympathy with not just the regular women in the country, the straight women, but also the lesbians. They wanted to make it a lesbian issue, which was, of course, this is what the homosexuals do all the time. They try to take over everything, and so she was shamed into this. A position where she had to admit. But what happened is that when she was at the University of Minnesota, she was a totally straight heterosexual girl. In fact, she was boy crazy. And she was pretty bitter because the boys were not as crazy about her as she was about them, because she made herself very unattractive. She was a beautiful woman, but she had this way of being very kind of macho and very strange and heavy-handed, and the boys just weren't attracted to her. And so that upset her a lot. But when she was at the University of Minnesota, this psychology professor, a woman named Helen Korn, seduced her and initiated her into lesbianism. Then she was 20 years old. So that when my aunt volunteered to send her to Oxford University as a postgraduate gift for two years at Oxford, they did it on the condition that she never had anything to do with Helen Korn again, because the family had found out what was going on. And this was a way of wrenching her away from this professor. So Kate promised faithfully that she would break up with Helen and she would go to Oxford. What happened is Kate sneaked Helen Korn into England with her. And this woman lived with her the whole 2 years she was at Oxford, getting her PhD, or no, her master's. She was getting her postgraduate degree at Oxford. And that woman lived with her and, used her car and lived in her apartment and was part of her life those whole 2 years. So when she came back, the family found out she had done that. And she was sort of banished from the family at that point. There were a number of people who never spoke to her again. But she was because a straight woman.
Yeah, but they felt betrayed.
Oh yeah.
Right. I mean, they felt that she was being dishonest with them. And then at what point did she get married?
Well, then she went to Japan after she had been teaching here in America a little while. Right after that, she went to Japan because she wanted to study art in Japan for some reason. I don't quite understand, but anyway, she went there and she rented an apartment from a couple who the man then came to America to live in Kate's loft in New York, and she was living with his wife in Japan, and his wife died while Kate was living with her. And so, of course, Fumio came hurrying back to Japan to be with his wife just as she died. And then the two of them cried on each other's shoulders. You know how that'll be. And eventually they ended up back here in New York living in Kate's loft, and they got married. His name was Fumio Yoshimura. He was an absolutely divine human being. I simply adored my brother-in-law Fumio. He was just a perfect gentleman, a lovely person. And they had a sexual, wonderful, for 17 years, they had a relationship, which then, because during that time, there was a period when sexual politics came out, and then she had to prove that she was a loyal lesbian, so she started getting involved with all these lesbians and being unfaithful to him. It broke his heart, absolutely broke his heart. He was extremely upset. And he ended up later marrying one of her students that she had kind of thrown at him. She was always saying, well, I'm sleeping around. Now you should sleep around too, because we should all be promiscuous, you know. So you need to learn to be promiscuous. Well, he didn't want to be promiscuous. So she got him together with one of her students at one point, and he ended up marrying her.
And so is this the period of time? Was she married when sexual politics came out?
Oh yes, oh very much married.
She was already.
That was
gotcha. Okay, was, so I'm just trying to get the,
right
just
the
trying to get the sequence here. Yeah.
Yeah, that was right in the middle of their happy marriage. I mean, I think they were married in about 1964 or 65 or something. and this is now 70, 71. So they had been together and quite happy for quite a while. But then she brought all this craziness.
And so how did he feel about sexual politics and all the fame that surrounded her?
Well, in the beginning, he was happy because he was thrilled that she was succeeding. And mm-hmm. But then it got overwhelming. I mean, fame, Dr. Morris, is it just a terrible thing to have happen to you. I've sat here and watched a couple of people I know now become very famous from being completely unknown, and it just destroys your life. And it destroys the lives of the people around you also, because it all starts to take over. And he just, after a while, you know, he was just a normal guy. He was a sculptor. He was a very, very ardent and very active artist who had shows, and he was getting to be very well known in New York. And he had wonderful art dealers who looked after him, and he was doing fine, and he was glad that she was succeeding too. But all this sexual stuff really broke his heart. He really mm-hmm. couldn't get into that. Now, he was mm-hmm. a Japanese man, you know. It just didn't work for him.
Right. And but Sexual Politics is itself a radical book, and then it sparked even further radicalism. And I've heard you talk, and I'd like you to tell our audience about the, you know, some of the times that you observed Kate with her radical friends and some of the things that they said and did and so on and so forth. But before you tell that, I want to try to get try to situate her marriage, the book, the radicalism, and the mental illness. You know, how did these things play into one another? And what was kind of the sequence of this? I mean, was she pretty normal when she was married to Fumio?
Well, there was a period when she seemed kind of normal. But you see, I had been in Asia the whole time, and I wasn't in contact with her when I was in there in Asia. Mm-hmm. So I just came back in 1968, 69. I ended up living with her in 1970 when this all broke out. And I was just sort of bewildered. I mean, when I came back to America, I didn't even know how to get my dry cleaning done anymore. I'd been gone for so many years, and I'd lived, you know, when you live in Asia and your husband is the president of an international corporation, you live a very, very exalted life. It's really, it's nothing like America. I mean, I had five servants who lived in. I had a 24-hour-a-day chauffeur. I had, you know, I was living the life. I lived in a gorgeous stone mansion outside of Manila, and I had a beautiful apartment in Hong Kong, and I was sort of bi-coastal then. I went back and forth between these two homes, and I was living the life. And so when I came back to America, I was so staggered by my culture shock. First of all, when I mm-hmm. left America, it was all little pillbox hats and white short gloves. When I left America.
Right.
When I came back 5 years later, 4 years later, it was hippies streaming by the thousands along Sunset Boulevard. The women had all turned into hippies. Everybody had hair down to their waist that was gone wild. I felt as if they had just removed my country while I was gone.
Mm-hmm.
I felt my country was kidnapped while I was gone, and I've never gotten it back. It's been a mm-hmm. huge shock for me. And then I came to New York, and Kate was in the middle of all the hippie stuff and the radicalism. But I have to say this, Dr. Morris, I just have to. I'm going to be 85 my next birthday, and I have to say, after a very long and very eventful life in which I've lived on three continents, I've known thousands and thousands of people, I've been everywhere and done everything, it is my opinion, it's just my personal opinion, that anybody who's into radical left politics is mentally ill. I just don't know anybody who's a sane person who's into this stuff. They're into promiscuity. They're into, you know, I mean, please, pedophilia. They believe in pedophilia. You know, that
right,
this is a
right.
good thing.
But
these people are really off.
Yeah. I'm aware of a lot of the things you're talking about, because this is what we talk about over here at the Ruth Institute all day long. You know, is the irrationality of a lot of what we're dealing with. But let's get back to your sister. Because I know a lot of people are going to be interested in that, you know, you're sharing a lot of valuable information here that I haven't seen anywhere else. It seems to me that you saw your sister shift into this kind of leftist mode and you were shocked by their agenda, I guess you would say. Can you share that with
Right.
people? Just to retell that story a little bit.
Well, you see, she was trying to indoctrinate me into all of this. There's a moment when my eyes were really opened because she took me to a meeting that she wanted me to join her, this women's group that where they're forming National Organization of Women, and she took me to a meeting one day where I sat at this table with about 14 other women. But when they would have these meetings, they would start the meeting with the chairperson. They had a roundabout of chair people. They change it up every meeting, and they would start the meeting by saying, "Why are we here today?" And the chairperson would say, "Why are we here today?" And then they would all chant, "To make revolution." And then the person would say, the chairperson would say, "What kind of revolution?" And then they would say, "The sexual revolution." And then what, you know, it would just be this. And how are we going to do that? By destroying the family. And they would say this: "How are we going to do that? By destroying marriage. How do we do that? By destroying monogamy. And how do we do that?" And then they would say, "By promoting homosexuality, prostitution, promiscuity, and abortion. We're going to promote those four things, and that will destroy the society." And they plotted this. This were like 14 decent American white young women who had gone to Vassar and, you know, all of these wonderful colleges, the high and Ivy League colleges, and they were sitting around a table. One of them was the niece of the Secretary of War under FDR. Stimson, Kate Stimson, was one of the members of this group. And they would say, "We've come here to destroy the family. And how do you destroy the family? By destroying monogamy. And you do that by promoting homosexuality, prostitution,
And
promiscuity, and
abortion.
abortion."
And
So these
abortion.
were
What
civilized women plotting to promote these things.
and
I
at
was
this
totally
point,
shocked.
yes, and I have heard you say that in other interviews, and it's in print in a couple of places, where you have described that. Was
Yeah.
Kate in her right mind at that time, or do you think she was mentally ill at that time? What do you think was going on?
I don't think Kate was ever in her right mind.
I see.
I don't think she was ever sane. I think that she was mentally ill. I've been through so many horrifying experiences. One time I was stuck in an apartment with her in Berkeley, California, and I was stuck in that apartment for 6 days with her, where I wasn't allowed to sleep for 1 hour during that time because she was so mentally ill. She was literally seeing little green men. She was frothing at the mouth. She would not sleep. She would not eat. I couldn't get her to do anything normal. I was terrified to go to sleep for fear she'd murder me. I was afraid I'd wake up with a knife in my back. I finally called our sister Sally in Nebraska and begged her to come and replace me because somebody had to be with her. Something had to be done about her. And I was due to go to Europe on a tour of a play I was in, and I had to leave. I couldn't stay with her any longer. And Sally came, and Sally had her committed. I mean, Sally
Is
went to
that right?
doctors.
Is that right?
Yeah. They did a
So,
whole thing, and she ended up in a hospital for a while.
tell me, did she ever have a diagnosis?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. She was preliminarily, it was bipolarism. And this is what they tell everybody who's nuts now. You're bipolar, you know, but it was not bipolar. She was just extremely mentally ill. She could not function like a normal human being. And she
So
had
was
so many
she?
whack-a-mole ideas and far-out concepts that she was pushing on everybody. And, well, pedophilia, which she wanted to normalize. I mean, this is not
Now,
sanity.
tell me about that. What did she ever write about that?
Yeah. In fact, I can read you something that she said about pedophilia. She was a very, I don't think you can ever talk about feminism without talking about the Marquis de Sade, and nobody ever brings up the Marquis de Sade, but that's a very important link.
Well, people are starting to bring him up now. He has his explicit defenders now. That is true.
Oh, you're kidding.
Mallory.
He has defenders?
No, I'm not kidding. No. Yeah, no, there are defenders. And you know, my kind of theory about the sexual revolution and pedophilia is that if you've got people who want to say that kids don't really need the protection of their parents, and that parents are allowed to, adults are allowed to have any sex lives they want, you have to somehow factor out of the equation the fact that kids normally need parents, right? And so in the process of, right? I mean, you know, if the kids are, you have to face up to the fact that kids need parents. And so if the parents are allowed to switch out their sex partners whenever they want, in your mind, at least, you have to say, well, kids don't really need parents. Somehow they're resilient, they're really miniature dolls. And in the extreme, what people are saying is, children are sexual beings. You know, that was the whole Alfred Kinsey line, right?
I'm sure.
But redefining childhood was part of the whole process of creating the sexual revolution and making it seem normal, you know, that people would switch out their sex partners all the time. That monogamy, if you're going to smash monogamy, you're going to end up with a lot of neglected kids. And so you have to somehow make that okay in your mind, you know, you have to rationalize that somehow. And one of the ways of rationalizing is that, well, kids don't really need their parents because really what kids need is privacy to have sex with each other. And maybe some adult will happen on and have sex with them. But really, kids want to have sex with each other, and that we should let that happen. No. This is what Wilhelm Reich thought. I think Kinsey thought that. You know, a lot of those guys thought that. But anyway, did you find the quote that you were looking for from your sister?
Yes, I did. Well, first of all, I think this whole crowd of people that brought this scourge upon us of this left-wing sexual revolution baloney. You know, I think maybe you'll agree with me that there's a group right around the 40s or 50s that started to misunderstand Descartes' statement, I think, therefore I am. I think they think I am whatever I think I am. I think they've taken Descartes' I think, therefore I am, and they've changed it to I am whatever I think I am, which is nonsense. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not whatever you think you are. You are what you are. But, you know, when it comes to the Marquis de Sade, you know, he's the one who brought out the business about abolishing all taboos. He was adamant about that all taboos had to go. And he was right in the middle of the French Revolution. You know, the French Revolution has a lot to do with this women's liberation thing, too. It all came out of the Marquis de Sade and the French Revolution. And Kate would state categorically that the complete destruction of traditional marriage and the nuclear family is the revolutionary or utopian goal of feminism. That is her statement of what feminism is.
I see. And was that explicitly in sexual politics? Was that as far back as sexual politics she was talking like that?
Get rid of taboos? Oh, yes. You had to get rid of all taboos.
The family, the destruction of the family was.
Oh, definitely. Oh, without a doubt.
Yeah. Okay. So did you find the quote? Did you find the quote about pedophilia that you wanted to share?
Yes, I did. She said, during an interview with Mark Blasius, she declared her sympathy for intergenerational sex, saying that, quote, and this is a direct quote from Kate, age of consent laws are very oppressive to gay male youth. One of children's essential rights is to express themselves sexually with each other, but with adults as well. The sexual freedom of children is an important part of a sexual revolution. If you don't change the social condition of children, you still have an inescapable inequality, Kate Millett believed. Sexual access to children is only one part of the larger goal of liberating children from all forms of parental oppression.
There it is.
Can you believe that?
Yeah, I do believe it. Yeah, sadly, I do believe that. Sadly, I do believe that. Yep.
She was so wacko. You know, one time my husband had to be alone for 3 weeks in an apartment with her. My mother was dying. Our mother was dying. And we couldn't let Kate anywhere near the health workers who were living with mother and doing a roundelay all day long to take care of her, because the minute they were exposed to Kate, they would all quit. You know, everybody left when Kate walked into the room. That was one of the things that you could count on, is that soon the room would be empty. So we couldn't have these wonderful women quit on mother. So my husband had to go and stay in our apartment that we had taken around the corner from mom. He had to stay there for 3 weeks with Kate. And I've never seen a bedroom door that had a lock on the inside like this, but strangely enough, the apartment we rented had that. And the whole time that he lived with her in that apartment, he had to keep that door locked whenever he was in the bedroom, because he said to me, I have no idea if she's going to come in the middle of the night and murder me or rape me. I didn't know which, but I didn't want either. So he had to lock himself away from her.
So here's the thing that puzzles me about this. It's not that I doubt what you're saying, okay? I have no reason to think you're exaggerating or to doubt you or anything like that. What I don't understand is, who is it within society who thought her ideas were so important that they should be promoted? I mean, somebody put her on the cover of Time magazine. You said they walked it back when they found out she was a lesbian, but these other things are just as damning, right? I mean, right, in their own way, to be in favor of abolishing the family and so on. Somebody thought it was a good idea. Somebody thought her ideas belonged in women's studies program. Who thought like that, Mallory? Well, what can you tell us about whose idea? Who helped her? You know, who facilitated
this
her?
This is all about the National Organization of Women and the founding of it. And it was Betty Friedan and Gloria Steinem and Kate and this whole group of women who got together to found National Organization of Women. And this was the basis of it all the time, was to get rid of marriage, to totally liberate women, that there's no difference between males and females, and we have to recreate society in order to go along with the basic real design, which is that we're not different from each other. I love it that right. They've just now come out with a new study from an Ivy League major school that the male and female brains are different. You saw that story come out last week, right?
Well, and the transgender movement has taken this into a whole nother realm of crazy, you know. But
well,
the feminism
laid
the...
Let me explain to you how this worked. See,
that's
this
what I
all
want to
came
know.
Out of this. Yeah, this all came out of the civil rights movement. These women that were met at that table that I was at those days, those women were all part of the civil rights movement. Everybody was working to bring the black population up to, you know, an equal level with the whites. And we really did have a racial problem in America. We did have a serious problem between the races. And so a lot of college kids, you know how it was, everybody at Berkeley, all the people at University of Minnesota and all that, got involved in the civil rights movement. And people were going down to Mississippi to march during those summers in the 60s and getting out, getting people, to, black people to vote and all of that. And these women were totally involved in that. But they got very upset because they were in all these meetings with all these liberation males who were just having to make the coffee. They were always sort of having the girls do that kind of stuff at the meetings, and they weren't really full members of those meetings along with the guys. And the women got very, very, very upset. And they finally said to each other, hey, we've had it with these guys. These left-wing male chauvinist pigs are really a pain in the neck, and we're going to start our own movement. We're going to start, why are we working to free black people when we're being treated this way? Let's have Women's Lib. And that's what Women's Lib came right out of it, dovetailed right out of the civil rights movement, so that they were sort of copying the whole civil rights movement. And that's how this movement started to flourish. And they just got so many, you know, followers and so many. And when she, you have to understand, that summer of 1970, when that book was published in 1970, the country was just ripe for this right at that moment. She wrote the exact right book at the exact right moment. It was sort of as if it was just chosen by Satan, you know, to be exact historically. And the minute that book came out, it just exploded. It was the Book of the Month Club. I mean, all the housewives in the Midwest were being told, this is the Book of the Month Club book, you know.
And
This
so,
was.
let me make sure I understand what you're saying, though, because I'm hearing two separate things, and I want to make sure that I'm fitting them together in my mind, because I want to understand what you're thinking here. That there was a great popular sympathy for the Black population in the United States, and the civil rights movement appealed to a certain kind of idealism. And so that desire for equality got translated into sexual equality, which, if you think about it, sexual equality is a different thing from racial equality. There are a lot of different aspects to it, right? That male and female actually are different, but nobody looked closely enough. No,
No.
is what I'm hearing you say. Nobody examined that closely enough to say, male and female. There are legitimate differences between male and female that you're never going to get rid of completely. And so translating the whole civil rights rhetoric into sexual politics is it's appealing. It's understandable why people are attracted to it, but it's not really the same thing. Is that your analysis of what happened?
Sure. Oh, yeah. It is what happened. It was sort of an evolution from the civil rights movement. The women just decided, well, why are we fighting for these other people to be free when we're not free? And these are all women who have problems with men. It's a male hating thing. So many girls get, hurt when they're 15 and 16 in the early dating years. There's hardly a girl who doesn't have something against some Jason or some, John or Jim, America gets on these tears. America has a real problem with this. We have a fad emerge, and then everybody's into it, and nobody bothers to examine it very closely. It's just the thing. It's the thing of the moment, and everybody gets into it, and they start having departments in the university about it, and it's just crazy the way we fall for fads, and we change our whole society. I mean, it's you. I don't know how old you are, but when we had an absolutely beautiful society when I left America in 1964. I mean, it was a utopian world, seriously. I've lived all over the world. When I came back from living all over the world and I would go to Minnesota, I would sit in people's living rooms, my family, and say, "You people live in utopia. You have no idea what the whole rest of the world is languishing in the throes of. You just don't know. You live this incredibly paradisical life here." And they would laugh at me. They thought I was exaggerating. I was not exaggerating. But these women came and they destroyed our society. And think of that. The women destroyed this society. These are the
But
people
here's
who are
the
supposed
thing.
to be the guardians.
Right. But here's the thing. Some men had to be helping them, Mallory.
Oh,
There
yeah.
were male editors at Time magazine who made these publication decisions. There were men running universities who made the decision that we need a women's studies program. Luxury beliefs, right? The if you're well to do, you can indulge yourself in beliefs that
Exactly.
aren't true,
Yeah.
and that the untruth hurts other people. It doesn't hurt you because you are college educated and you have a nice job and so on. But poor people, their lives are being destroyed by the breakdown of the family, and the educated classes never see that. They have no idea. So are you telling me then that that what you saw and what your sister was part of was this sort of wholesale translation from the civil rights movement into sexual politics with nobody really looking too closely. And I'm not as old as you are, but I do remember some of this stuff. What the way I describe my situation in this, how I situate in this history, is that when I was a little girl, it was okay to say, I want to be a mommy when I grow up. But by the time I got to college, it was no longer okay to say that. Right. And so somehow my life, spanned that way. So I have some memories of what you're talking about. But it just puzzles me that there were people in positions of responsible positions who could not look ahead, two steps ahead of their,
Well,
could not
think of
see the
this.
nose on their face, to say, look, if you make it easy for people to divorce, there's going to be a lot of wreckage. There are going to be a lot of problems.
Well, that was also a thing that died. Not only the family, but common sense also died. But the thing is, I mean, we have no common sense anymore at all. And we really lived by common sense in America. Really, everybody had, it was, sense was common, and it really was common. But, you know, feature this. The day that she went to defend her thesis, I was living with her in her loft on the Bowery. And I remember she was so nervous that morning. She and Fumio and I had breakfast together. We always had breakfast together in the morning. And she was a wreck. She had to go and defend her thesis. And she kept saying, "You don't understand. You don't understand. It's an entire panel of men. They're all men up there. And they're going to kill me. They're going to hate this. They're going to hate my thesis. And I'm going to flunk. I'm not going to get it." So she comes home that night walking on clouds because the panel of men that viewed her defense of her thesis was all men, and they gave her first honors unanimously. They read Sexual Politics. They gave her first honors. So you can blame these men. You know, I don't know what was wrong with them. But, you know, she was involved in the Columbia riots. She and Mark.
But hold on. Before we leave the men, I want to hear about the Columbia riots. But before we leave her thesis committee, okay, she could have drawn different conclusions from that. She could have said, "Gee, these four guys or five guys or however many it was, they listened to reason. They treated me with respect. Maybe I don't need this radical response. Maybe we don't really need to dissect the entire society." But that's not what she concluded. Right.
Oh, no, because she would never do that because she was a maladjusted person from the time she was 6 years old. She always hated society. She always hated men. She always hated boys. I mean, we shared a bunk beds the whole time I was growing up. For the first 9 years of my life, I slept in the bottom bunk and she slept in the top bunk. And she would just be raging half the night, screaming up to the ceiling about boys and how much she hated boys and how she wished she were a boy. I always tell people now that if Kate were just about 18 or 19 now, she'd be transitioning. She'd be growing a beard.
Because she simultaneously hated herself as a woman. And hated men. She wanted to be a man, but she hated men. So she's a deeply conflicted person here.
Oh, and something I always leave out. I've never put this in. I always leave it out, and it's key. She developed breasts very young. She was a very pretty young girl. And then when she was about, I think, around 12 or 13, she began to develop breasts, and they became huge. She had D-cup breasts by the time she was 14 or 15, and she hated it. She was just traumatized by this. She would come home and she'd say, "Nobody even looks at my face anymore. Nobody ever looks at my face. They're just staring at my breasts every second. I can't stand this." She was so upset, and so she learned to hate her body. And that was a big part of it. That was a very big part of it. The early development.
Yeah, because, that's so interesting that you're saying that, because hatred of the body and conflict with the body is a deep part of the sexual revolution. You know, it's one of those odd things that we're simultaneously indulging our bodies by saying, "Well, if I have a sexual urge, I'm going to scratch it," you know. But at the same time, we resent our bodies. We resent the demands of the body, you could say, you know, that if we have sex, we have a baby, and now we're physically connected to that baby, and we have obligations to that baby and the baby's other parent, and, you know, and we hate all that, you know.
Menstruation. Menstruation.
Never mind.
We called
that.
It the curse.
Right. You never know. Mind that. So just deeply, deeply conflicted about the body, about her. This is characteristic of your sister, deeply conflicted about her body. But my comment was that she could have drawn different conclusions about her, about men, based on how they treated her and her thesis, but she didn't. And you started to tell us something about the Columbia riots. Tell us about that, her involvement with that.
Well, she and, you know, Bill Ayers, the guy who got Barack Obama elected.
Yes.
You know who Bill Ayers is from Columbia?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Bill Ayers and Mark Rudd and Kate Millett started the Columbia riots in 1969. They were the three generators of the Columbia riots. You remember there was this huge period of time, weeks and weeks, where the Columbia students were rioting, and they took over all the buildings, all the official buildings of the school. They took over The professors had to leave. They were camped out all over the roof and all over the balconies and everywhere, and they were rioting. And my sister was one of the leaders of that riot. So she was just a troublemaker. Kate just wanted to upend whatever was institutionalized. Anything that was there, she wanted to go and wreck it. And I also have to tell you another thing, Dr. Morris. You see, this really was exacerbated by the fact that when she was 18, she went to work at a mental institution. She took a summer job at St. Peter's Hospital in St. Paul, Minnesota, or in Minnesota. It's somewhere out in Minnesota. I don't not know quite where it is. In St. Peter. I guess it's the town of St. Peter. She went and worked as a nurse's aide at a mental institution in 19... Let's see, she would have been in 1953 or so. 1952 or 53, at a very, very impressionable age, she went to work in this insane asylum, and she came back so traumatized. She would lie awake at night telling me horrible stories about the women refusing to wear clothes, running around naked, eating mice, killing mice and eating them, some women who tore all their hair out, the terrible way that they were treated. She said it was just a nightmare of a mental institution that was just sort of like, what was that thing that Jack Nicholson
One flew over the cuckoo's nest.
Yes.
One flew over the cuckoo's nest. Mm-hmm.
It really was, and it was really bad, I guess, at St. Peter's. Kate was so traumatized when she came home, so that she actually took that trauma and worked herself fully into her own insanity, that then she ended up herself in mental institutions. And it was all stemming from that St. Peter's experience. I'll never forget how traumatized she was coming home from that job.
But she was already...
mentioned that.
Yeah, but she was already unstable, is what you're
totally.
Telling me. You know, that she... Yeah, yeah. And so that was like putting her over the
edge. She was already naughty as a fruitcake. Yeah, she was completely naughty as a fruitcake. I mean, I can't even tell you how crazy she was and the things that she would do. And so for her to go there and be then with all these mentally ill people, that was not a good move for my mother to let her do that. I don't know what in the world the family was thinking.
No. So Kate's 5 years older than you, and your mom is raising the three of you girls as a single mom. What was your mom's reaction to Kate's outbursts or Kate's behavior, Kate's condition? Was your mom?
Well, first of all,
go ahead.
First of all, my dad left when Sally was 17. She had just gone to Mills College, so Sally had left the home and was boarding at school. So there was just mom and Kate and I and me and my father. And I think once Sally was gone. He adored Sally, and once Sally was gone, he was having to deal with Kate, who was just, as I've described. And my mother's response to Kate's insanity was protectivism. She protected
her.
She was there to protect Kate and to let KB baby. She would call her KB baby. KB baby, I love you, my baby. She would just dote all over her because she thought that Kate was like this because she didn't feel loved enough or something. And so I was kind of left like on my own because I wasn't causing this kind of trouble. So I was regulated. I was doing things the way you should. And so my mother sort of took her eye off me, and she just had both eyes on Kate. And she pampered her and babied her and went along with her. If I would talk to mother about how impossible Kate was, she would go against me. You see, I realized much later that she was terrified of Kate. She was really afraid.
Yeah.
She was very violent, and she would attack my mother. My mother never got to be 5 feet tall. She was a 4'11 and weighed 98 pounds her entire life. She was a little tiny woman, and she was scared to death of this big bully because Kate was 5'5, 6 inches taller than she was, and 5'4.
And, you know, I can imagine, even without your father's alcoholism, I can picture the conflict in the home. You know, if you've got this very difficult child and maybe dad's trying to keep order or impose constraints or rules or whatever, and mom is doting and protecting. Even without your dad's alcoholism, this is not a good recipe, it seems to me. It's a shame that he left. I mean, obviously, it's a shame that this, for his alcoholism. And who knows what would have been different. And I wonder how she would be treated today if she was behaving in those ways. But anyway, so let's see, where do we leave the story here? We left the story with Kate and Bill Ayers and Mark Rudd being the instigators of the riots at Columbia. What can you tell us about her circle of friends? Did she have lifelong friends who were loyal to her over long periods of time, or did she cycle through friends and groups of people? She had
some lifelong friends that were still from her childhood in Minnesota. People who, you see, people tended to feel protective toward Kate for some reason. I mean, she could do the most outrageous things. I mean, she could set your house on fire, you know, and people would just say, oh, well, you know, I have no idea why. Everybody was so sympathetic to Kate because she was not a sympathetic person. I mean, she was very rough and tough. She was very in your face. She was very, profane. She was a tough dame, you know. I'll tell you, who was that woman that hated Donald Trump so much? What's her name? She was so much like her. She's a famous personality. Oh, I can't remember her name. She was just one of these. She was like a guy. She wasn't feminine at all, you know. She was very masculine and very rough and tough. Her language was very profane. She would just open her mouth and say anything that was just not appropriate. She did have some lifelong friends, and I think it was because they felt protective toward her the way Mom did, you know. They were trying to get her over it. Everybody was always trying to get her over it, but she was just a problem person.
And was she institutionalized for any length of time?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. She was, and we tried so hard to get her institutionalized. One time there was a major episode. We had several episodes, but there was one major episode where, you know, even all of her friends really, you know, we would confer with her friends and they would confer with us. And there came a time when we all just said, look, something's got to be done. She was too world famous for to be raging around the world this nuts, because it was going to come out, you know, eventually it would get out. So although I'm surprised, when people are famous, their craziness is protected for some strange reason. You know, it can be raging around totally insane and the public doesn't even know about it, you know. But there was just a time when we decided to have an intervention. So we all gathered at her loft. I think this was around 1981 or 82. We all gathered at her loft, and there were about 14 of us. One of them was Phyllis Chesler, who's kind of a famous psychiatrist in the women's movement, and she was one of Kate's best friends. And she was going to be the psychiatrist who signed off on it. So we actually had a psychiatrist there in our group who loved Kate, but knew she had to be hospitalized. So we all had this meeting with her, and she was ranting and raving and raging and just being as insane as she could possibly be with 12 or 13 of us there. And we were trying to talk sense with her and trying to get her to calm down and realize that she just had to get help. Meanwhile, we had two ambulances showing up, plus several police officers. So we had arranged this whole thing for a couple of weeks, and then we pulled it on her. And we had this meeting for several hours upstairs. My husband was banished to some restaurant down the street because we didn't want a man to be there because that would upset her. So eventually we brought her down the three flights from her loft down to the Bowery, down to the street. And there was a policeman waiting there. And the minute that we got down to the street, she had been raging crazy every minute that we were with her for several hours. The minute that she saw that policeman, she was totally sane. All of a sudden, we were all standing out on the sidewalk waiting for her to be put into the ambulance that was sitting there waiting. And this policeman had to validate it, you know. And so he had to do a little question and answer thing with her. And the minute he started that with her, she went completely sane on the button, totally sane. And my husband and I, our jaws were on the ground. We were just... He never realized that she was willfully crazy, that she was just doing this, you know, because she could be sane on the instant, right there. And she started quoting chapter and verse to this policeman of her rights as an American citizen. You have no right to violate my civil rights by hospitalizing me against my will, et cetera, et cetera, and quoting chapter and verse. And the policeman finally looked at my husband and me and said, I can't agree to this woman being committed. She seems perfectly sane to me. There were 12 of us standing out on the street with our, we just all just collapsed. I mean, we just, all of our shoulders just went down 3 inches, you know, we were beaten.
Mm-hmm.
You see, the three things that Kate did to our society is the complete overtaking of our society by the women's movement, because once they had the National Organization of Women, she was the head of the education committee. And so she packed her suitcases and went all over America and founded all the women's studies courses in all the universities. She personally went from school to school to school and founded the women's studies classes and set up the syllabus and, you know, mm-hmm. all the reading and everything. She did that. Okay, so that's, you can blame her for that, totally. I mean, really, that was Kate. And mm-hmm. second of all, once she had done that, she was so proud of herself that she decided, okay, so now I have to do the Mental Patients Project. So she started a group in New York City called the Mental Patients Project to state that there's no such thing as insanity. Insanity does not exist. It's just a position of culture, the way you just get rid of troublesome people or people who are eccentric or don't think just the way you do. That's all it is. There's no such thing as insanity. That was their basic premise. So they ended up, lobbied the city council in New York City, and New York City on one day, Dr. Morse, in one day, they released every mental patient in New York, was taken and put out on the street from psychiatric wards. Now, people, you think back, it was, I believe it was 1975. There was this one day, we had New York one day, and the next day there was mental patients all over the streets, Dr. Morse. They were everywhere, lying around in doorways and stuff, and the kids and gangs of teens were coming and beating them up and putting cigarettes out on them and stealing from them, and it was a terrible, terrible thing that she caused. And then after they did that in New York, they started doing it in every city in America. So she's responsible for that. It's not a homeless situation we have in America. It's a mental illness situation.
Right, right.
These are mostly people need to be in mental institutions. They shouldn't
they
be out alone. Yeah,
they
shouldn't be
help.
Abandoned on the street. This is unmerciful, you know?
Right.
It's terrible. And then the third thing she did was that she and Simone de Beauvoir fomented the Iranian Revolution. These two women, plus Simone de Beauvoir and her husband and Kate, the three of them, sat in Simone de Beauvoir's left-wing apartment a number of summers plotting this thing they were going to do in Iran because they wanted to overthrow the Shah and create the great communist laboratory, the Marxist showcase. Iran was going to be turned into a Marxist dream place. So they plotted this, and they actually did it. Those two women, see, people don't know this. And this is not something I'm exaggerating or I'm making up because it's my sister. No, no, no. I lived through this whole thing. These two women thought up that revolution, and they created the whole – the Ayatollah was in Paris at the time, and they were dealing with him, and they were trying to get him back. They were going to – I don't know. Somehow he snookered them, made them think he was going along with their idea of the communist Marxist revolution and everything. The minute they got the Ayatollah back there, he turned on them and he deported Kate. Kate was in Iran and he deported her. And he forsook the entire group of people that had built him up and trained him to do this thing. So she's also responsible for the Iranian revolution, which is, it sounds grandiose and crazy for me to say this, but I happen to know it's a fact. She was there from March 4th.
So wait a minute. Let me make sure I'm getting this straight. That she and Simone de
Beauvoir,
you know who I mean, Simone de Beauvoir and Jean-Paul Sartre, that the three of them thought that if they could get rid of the Shah, that the Ayatollah would be a good Marxist, Leninist, communist. That's what they thought. Is
I
that
think they thought
what
they
you
were going
told
to
them?
snooker him. I think they thought they were going to snooker him, and he did it right back. You know, it's
Right,
just, this
right.
is
They
what
had
these
no
people are
idea. They
like.
had no idea that he had his own idea of a revolution.
Sure, right. But, you know, she
Right.
went to Iran on March 4th, 1979, in the middle of that revolution. She went there, and she led a march of 100,000 women down the main street of Tehran. Now, I've been to Tehran, so I know this street. I know this boulevard. That she led 100,000 people down this boulevard, and she got up in the main square and gave a big address, a huge speech, where she described women's liberation and how it was, this whole Muslim thing was terrible and the women had to be equal and everything. And she called the Ayatollah a male chauvinist pig. And so within 2 nights, they were knocking at her door at 3 o'clock in the morning, and the Iranian cops came and took her away and put her in jail. She and her photographer, a woman whom she later married, she and the photographer were thrown into jail and kept there for a couple of days until they ended up just putting her them on a plane to Paris and throwing them out of the country. But she made trouble everywhere she went, is the key to Kate.
And
You couldn't have her
what
anyplace.
and what these three things have in common that you're describing is all three of them, in a sense, you could say, are fantasy ideologies. She had
Yeah.
a utopian vision of how things were going to be that did not take account of either human nature or did not take account of historic reality, that would be existing in Iran. And the Persian Empire and the whole historical thing that's much bigger than Kate and her ideas. And the fantasy triumphed in her mind. The fantasy took precedence over reality every time, is what I'm
Well, here,
hearing you tell me.
this is a thing I wrote to Carrie Gress. You know who Carrie Gress is,
I
right?
sure do. I sure
Yeah.
do.
Well, this is what I wrote to Carrie Gress. Kate went
Okay.
on to create a strong bond throughout the 1970s with Simone de Beauvoir, whom she would visit regularly in Paris. Simone was the official chair of Comité International du Droit des Femmes. So the committee of the liberation of international liberation of women, she was the official chair of that in Europe. Every time Kate went to Paris to hang out with Simone and her cronies, François Mitterrand would ceremoniously and personally meet Kate at the airport in a luxurious black limousine. Mitterrand would come and meet Kate personally, and bring her in the limousine out of the airport. It was during those years that she and Simone and other dubious creatures of the left bank concocted the Iranian Revolution of 1979, deluding that it would be the great Marxist breakthrough, a laboratory test tube example of Marxism succeeding in the modern world. Except that the Ayatollah Khomeini stole it out from under them the minute he was re-ensconced back in Tehran. My daughter and I lived around the corner from Kate, and she kept insisting she had to go to Tehran. And I did everything I could to stop her, trying to make her see she dare not go since it was just too dangerous. There's a war going on there. She flew to Iran in the week of March 4th, 1979, and led this women's march up the main boulevard. And she got up and called the Ayatollah a male chauvinist pig.
Now,
So.
I'm interested to know what happened to the women who were marching with her. Was there a crackdown against them by the Ayatollah?
Oh, you bet. And you know, they see Kate was going to take them out of the veil. You know, they didn't want to wear the veil anymore. They didn't want to, you know, and this was their big terror that Ayatollah was coming back and he was going to put them under the veil. And of course he did.
Right.
And that's what happened. I mean, Kate and Simone were thrown out. And you know, every single day, that entire 10 days or so that she was in Iran before she was thrown out, she was on the phone with Gloria Steinem. Now, Gloria, now this is a piece of history that nobody knows, but I absolutely know it because I was there. I experienced the whole thing. She was on the phone every single day from Iran to Gloria Steinem, and they talked maybe two or three times a day. So Gloria Steinem was kind of running the Iranian Revolution. Can you
Really,
believe that?
really.
Oh, yeah.
Do you think, you think Gloria Steinem, but Gloria Steinem doesn't strike me as impulsive as your sister, as the way you're describing your sister. Did
No,
she
but this
think
was
this
at a
was going to
different
work?
time. You know, this was at a different time. This was 1979. Things were kind of different then. And Kate and Gloria were working a lot in a lot of different things together. I mean, they were like girlfriends, you know. They had known each other a long time. They'd been in and out with all these committees and groups they had. And so the minute she was in Iran, Gloria wanted the dope. You know, Gloria wanted to know everything that was happening. And she was going bzz, 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 bzz in Kate's ear. And then Kate was meeting with all these women who were running this. There were a lot of women who were behind this thing in Iran. And there was like a whole group. And they were working as a body, you know. And Gloria was filtering all these ideas in. So that's a shocker that the world doesn't know. And if I dare announce this to the world, they'd say I'm full of it, you know. But I know for a fact that that's what was going on.
Well, and you know, I just want to say, Mallory, that I appreciate you talking to me because I want to get your recollections on tape. And, you know, perhaps at some point somebody will listen to what you've had to say and go and verify different parts of it, because some of the things you've said can be verified, it sounds like, you know.
Oh, sure.
Not just the documents that you've got, but, you know, but they can or they cannot be verified, right? But other people, you've created something here. This conversation is giving people something to work with to say, here is an alternative picture of what was going on in the women's movement, of what it was all about for them. It wasn't just about what it seemed to be about. It was also about Marxism. It was also about fantasy ideology. It was also about mental illness. It was about a lot, and it was about hatred, like a lot of anger and hatred against men is part of what you're telling me about your sister, in addition to her body image issues, you know? So there are a lot of threads that you've shared with us here that I think are going to be valuable for people to look at, to assess, to just create a more complete picture of the feminist history than we've had so far. I mean, you know, and I know that when people talk about the sexual revolution, there is an approved narrative, you know, there's a grand march of history and, you know, and you're only allowed to think one thing about it, you know, and it's almost like a set of cartoons. Where everybody is marching in lockstep towards the great progressive, you know, end state of history, you know. And so the things that you're sharing with us are important correctives to that. I appreciate it very much.
It's not in part left wing. It's totally, it's Marxism. It's what Karl Marx set up. You know, what you do is you separate society into groups, and you make each group discontent with the society, group by group by group. Now, the biggest group to do this to is the women. If you get the women, you've got the country. This is a part of left-wing revolutionary philosophy. If you get the women, you've got the country. So that's what they did. This was a deliberate moving in by the Marxists. You know, you had these teachers she had, the kind of people that she was associating with. Nathanson, the abortion guy, Dr. Nathanson was in my house and in my life for years. You know, these are all left-wing, very far left-wing revolutionary people who wanted to create Marxism. And wherever they were, and it wasn't just in part that, it was all about that. And they do this now. They've got the homosexuals. They take them and they do that with them.
Now, hold on. But now Nathanson actually repented and recanted and reported a lot of things that. Yes. And so were you friendly with him after his, what shall we call it? Conversion experience? Were you friendly with him at that point as well?
I knew the priest that baptized him. I knew the priest who brought him into the church later. Wow. See, now I'm a devout Catholic, and I'm a lector at St. Patrick's Cathedral. I'm very, very much into religion, into God and Jesus Christ, and my husband and I live that sort of life because we came back to that together once we met 45 years ago. We both came back into the church together, and we ended up getting married in the church. And but this is all about a war on God. Whenever you go to any of these people, you'll find they're all atheists. They don't believe in God.
And the reason the Catholic Church is a problem to them is that the Catholic Church is telling us we don't get to do whatever we want. and whatever the substance of that is, no, you don't get to do whatever you want just because you want it. That's not enough. You know, that won't work. And we're always the ones saying that, you know, since going back to the Roman Empire, we've been saying that, you know, and it always gets us in trouble. But I do want to go back to, let's see, it was what
Well,
you
I just
said,
wanted to add
something
to
you,
that. The
go
Marquis de
ahead.
Sade stated, you know, I want to add to that. The Marquis de Sade stated there's no such thing as sin. You know, this is their,
Right.
they believe there's no such thing as evil,
Right. Right.
that anything you want to do is okay. Well,
Right. Right.
come on.
And they think that the taboos are the problem. And Sade, Marquis de Sade is part of, obviously part of that. You know, if people weren't uptight about it, it would be okay. Right.
Yeah,
And kids don't
right.
really mind. Children don't really mind all these things. It's just the fact that adults are upset about it. That's the only thing. And I'm here to tell you, Mallory, I don't know how much you know about me and the Ruth Institute, but we've done quite a bit of work on childhood sexual abuse and clergy sex
Oh.
abuse, because I feel it's re I feel responsible that I need to speak about it. And so I've interviewed a lot of people who have had these experiences. I haven't met a single one who would say, you know, the only thing that bothered me is that the adults were upset. You know, no, they it was painful to them. It was shameful. They knew instinctively, immediately that it was wrong. You know, they didn't need to be
Right.
told it was wrong. They knew it was wrong. You know, in the body, they knew that it was wrong.
Right.
Mallory, is there any evidence that the Comintern, that the Soviets, had anything to do directly with the feminist movement in America?
The Soviets, Well, well, I have
They
to
had their
say
fingers.
that.
They had their fingers in a lot of the other pies, I know, but I've never seen anything authoritative that the Soviets were, you know, whispering in Gloria Steinem's ear or sending her money or anything. You know, I mean, do you know
Well, but you
anything
know,
about
it
that?
was a, you know, I'll tell you. One Sunday morning, I was sound asleep in my loft on the Bowery, and I woke up to the phone at 7 a.m. and it was Vanessa Redgrave. And I mean, she said, "This is Vanessa Redgrave," and I thought, "Oh, ha, you know, this is some friend." No, she had been talking to Kate. Kate was newly famous, and she knew all the famous people suddenly. And she had told Vanessa Redgrave that I was an actress and I was part of a comedy troupe. And Vanessa is a rock solid communist. I mean, Vanessa is real communist and always has been. But no, there was a big connection. They were promoting this here. Of course, it was all to their advantage, you know.
Well, and
Any
then
young but
there was the whole group at Columbia Teachers College and at Columbia University. That was a big that was a big hotbed of it. That was a like a revolving door.
Yeah.
Right. But right. Okay, so that's an interesting recollection, what you just said there. But
Yeah.
in some cases, you can actually see Russian influence or Soviet influence on things. You know, you can see them dealing with certain civil rights figures, not Martin Luther King, as
Yeah.
far as I know, but you know, a number of civil rights leaders had communist backing and were communists and so on and so forth.
Yeah,
And
Solilinsky, the
oh
Solilinsky
oh oh
thing. Yeah,
yeah oh yeah yeah
these people are
of course
all,
Saul Alinsky. Right, right,
yeah,
right.
and they're
And
all
then there's
connected. They're
the
all communists.
and now we naively thought that when the Soviet Union fell, that we were done with this. Okay.
Oh,
But what's right? But what seems to me has
yeah.
happened is that the communist idea, which is really a totalitarian idea, to my mind, I'm just going to put my cards on the table here, Mallory, since we're becoming old friends here in these 90 minutes that we're talking. To my mind, the whole egalitarian communist ideal is really a cover story for a power grab, and I think the feminist story is a cover story for a power grab. You know, they're being mean to you. We're going to
Absolutely.
rescue you. We're going to rescue you. And so that morphs. It seems like the particulars of that pattern have morphed over time, and it's got a new label on it. You know, it's been rebranded a little bit, but it's basically the same idea. We have a fantasy
No, this is
ideology
their
for you.
technique.
Yeah,
Yeah, this is their
we, yeah.
technique. They get the young people and they find out what they're dissatisfied about. And then they abrase that. They just whip up those dissatisfactions. And that's what the communist movement was about. It was about isolating all these different, complaints that people have, and sort of making it into a thing, you know, and then not, so the people don't really realize they're really getting into the Communist Party is actually what they're doing. They don't really
But
know
I'm
it.
what I'm saying something a little different than that. I'm not disagreeing, but I'm saying the Communist Party doesn't exist anymore in the same way, but the accumulation of power is going on under different labels. That's all I'm saying. So whether
definitely.
it is or
Oh,
isn't,
no, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
Yeah,
no, that old
Mallory.
Communist Party thing is an old remnant. Now it's they've played their way through everything now. They have taken over the thinking of our country, really.
People aren't able to think critically. They're reactive. We're always reacting all the time to these stimuli that are being put out. There's an injustice, and we all have to jump up and down and do what we're told to make the injustice go away, you know. And the feminists really sharpened that to a great degree. I mean, it's one thing if you scapegoat the kulaks, you know, the rich peasants or something. It's another thing if you scapegoat half the human race, the male half of the human race, you know, and you create divisions in society on that scale. Which is what they were trying to do. Mallory, I didn't anticipate that we'd be everything that we would be talking about. I want to go back to your sister and see if there are other things that you want to share with us, if there's anything we've missed, because a couple of times you've said, oh, I always forget to say this. Is there anything else that you'd like to add about your sister that you think would help people to understand who she was and her legacy?
Well, you know, all I know is that any time I have a chance to talk to, say, an 18 or 19-year-old girl right now in 2024, if I'm talking to a perfectly normal-seeming 20-year-old girl who's in college, and the minute she opens her mouth, all this commie propaganda comes out. She doesn't have any idea that's what she's mouthing. She doesn't have any, just that. Even the people who seem halfway normal and halfway decent and who don't seem that they're on this track are already in it. I mean, all the kids have been just taken in by it. Everybody who's in college is being fed all of this propaganda. And it's de rigueur, you know. It happens in math class. It happens in, you know, in history class. It happens in literature class. It happens everywhere. These people are all Marxists. The people who are teaching in our schools, this is a terrible thing. America has given up her soul to communist ideologists, and they don't really understand that they've done that. They have no idea what their kids are hearing and what's being taught to their kids. I'm so frustrated over the whole thing. I've been watching this for 50 years now as these people, I sat at that table where they said, we will infiltrate the judiciary, all of the establishment, all of the colleges will infiltrate everything, and that's how we'll put our thing across. And I'm sitting here 50 years later, and they did it. They did infiltrate everything, everything. There's nothing they haven't infiltrated.
And I think the psychological response to your sister is telling. And I'm glad that you just kind of described it. People can make of it what they will, right? But you described how your parents reacted to her and her personality and her problems. And this, I think there's, it in political terms, it's appeasement. You know, you think you've got a loud mouth here. We're going to make them be quiet. You can't really make them be quiet. You know, really, you've just kicked the can down the road and strengthened them, you know. But I think if people can, you know, listen to what you've had to say and hear that pattern, maybe people can start to recognize that pattern and to understand that you really can't make nice with these things, you know. Compromising or giving in is not really a long-term strategy. You know, it's appeasement, and so you have to put up with the the cost of dealing with somebody who's really unpleasant to deal with, whether they're certifiable, like your sister was, you know, certifiably mentally ill, or whether they're just obnoxious or whatever it is,
I didn't tell you what the upshot of her of that policeman not putting her away that day.
Oh, yes.
The upshot
Please finish
was
that story.
The upshot was that she got onto a plane that night and flew to Shannon, Ireland, which was what she'd been planning all along. And our trying to capture her and put her in a hospital was going to keep her from meeting that airplane flight. And so she got on that plane, and she flew to Shannon, Ireland. And by the time she had been in Ireland for 24 hours, she was committed to a mental institution in Ireland by the police at the Shannon airport. She went to the Shannon airport. She got out of the plane. She had $250,000 of movie equipment with her. And she was terrified of being in possession of all this valuable equipment. So she hid in the ladies' room at Shannon Airport and wouldn't let anybody come into the ladies' room. She had all of her equipment there, and she wouldn't let anybody come in. So nobody could pee in the Shannon Airport for several hours until they came and got the police to pick her up and put her in a mental institution in Shannon. So we find out a day after she leaves that she's already in a mental institution in Ireland. And she summoned all of her, you know, she had these groupies everywhere in the world, in every country in the world. There were millions of women who idolized her. So all she had to do was pick up a phone, and she got a few Irish women to show up at this mental institution, and they helped her escape. She sneaked out a window. She did a whole thing, and they bore her off to freedom. And so you can see that she was that mentally ill that when she was let loose, it just into a foreign country where nobody knew her, they ended up putting her in a mental institution.
And where they didn't have a lot of the same kind of protocols that we have over here for that. Yeah.
I guess not. Yeah.
This conversation has been really fascinating, and I did not want to interrupt you unnecessarily. You know, I wanted to give you as much. I had to interrupt you a few times because I didn't want to lose a thread, you know. But
you're a really great interviewer. I love your interview. It's great.
Oh, well, thank you. That's very kind, and I really do think people are going to be blessed by the perspective that you've offered, even if they don't agree with what you've said.
Yeah.
They have to confront it. You know, they can. It gives them a broader perspective than to say that, you know, Kate Millett was a saint or something. You know, feminism has been the greatest thing ever. You know, that kind of thing. You've given people some perspective, and for that I really thank you, Miss Mallory. I really
so much.
Appreciate it very much. And
I do too.
Before I let you go, I want you to give out the name of your website and places where people might be able to find whatever writing you've done.
Oh, well, I have a website. It's Mallory Millett, MallorymillettT.com. And I've got a lot of articles and many interviews on there. And if people are interested, excuse me, there's a lot of material there.
Well, Mallory Millett, thank you so much for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show. This has been one of the most fascinating conversations I've had in a long time.
Oh, I'm so happy to hear that. I hope you got a good interview. If you need anything more, just let me know.
Great. Thanks for watching. Please leave a comment telling us what you thought about the video.